you have to read out the Rig Veda from yourself. That is what you are expected to practice in the name of reading the scriptures. That is given as instructions in these volumes. That is why these volumes are also called by the same name. But Veda does not mean this volume, but it means something which is described in this volume. That is the reader or the disciple whose life is described as one book, whose voice and utterance is described as Rig Veda, whose pulsation of life and the respiration as the song of life are described as Samaveda in the second book. And your mind is called the third one, Yajurveda. So the plan of creation is given in this volume, Yajurveda. It is also said that the plan of your life is planned through your mind. So your mind is described as the third volume, which contains the work or the plan of your life. This is also called the ritual or the sacrifice, because your life is the result of the sacrifice of the devas, and also your existence is due to the sacrifice of the omnipresent Lord. He has sacrificed himself into all of us. We are born out of himself. We live by taking his flesh and blood. We live by eating him as our daily food. Therefore, the creation is called his sacrifice. And our first duty is also expected as sacrifice in his work. This sacrifice is described in the third volume. And then the fourth volume is called your mundane life, which includes your economic, professional and social activities and the sciences that are required to live that life. So the fourth volume includes the wisdom of healing and medical science, the administrative sciences, the economics and the political science. So this is the syllabus of the four scriptures in India. All these exotic volumes have their original volume in every one of you. By reading these volumes, you are expected to read the original volume. If you read all these volumes carefully, and if you fail to read the original volume, that is, if you fail to put these things in practice in your life, then you will be a very, very great scholar without any real use at all. Just as a dinner is served on the table, many delicious dishes and a nice photograph taken of all these things. If you invite your friends for dinner on your birthday, ask them to sit at the dinner table and distribute copies of these photos to them, the result will be the same. They will have a nice photograph of the dinner, but poor fellows, they have to go home and eat. Similarly, if you make a thorough study of all these four volumes, you fail to read them in the original volumes that exist in you, it is a big failure. You have to make the real dinner once again in the next birth, because no use at all. Therefore, it is called the manuscript by Blavatsky. Esoterically, manuscript means the script of man. That means that which is written as the life of the human being. It is also described as the biography, means the science of life. She also describes in the Isis Unveiled that There were two biographers to the book. The one started to compile the whole book, but he died without completing it. And his son had to complete it. That means the whole creation as a book is complete only as being handed down from father to son in the form of the creation and the evolution through generations from the consciousness as the father through the nature as the mother into the creation as the generation of the children. This symbolism is common to all the scriptures in the world. Common. You know how God is the father in every scripture and how the nature aspect is the mother and how the father comes down as the child into the creation in the form of the spirit that descends into the soul and then into the psychological vehicle and then into the matter of our bodies. So this symbolism is common to all the world scriptures. This is the meaning of the book. Blavatsky describes that it is written on palm leaves. It is also esoteric. Here palm means hands. It is written on palm leaves means our life is written in the form of the work we do, which we create as our future, which the science calls karma. It means our life is our creation. Though we are God's creation, we are created by God, but we create our own careers, the good and bad. God created only good. We create good and bad. So, we create problems and we create solutions. God created neither problems nor solutions, but He created the heaven and the earth.
Aber er hat
the day and the night, the sun, the moon, the stars and the planets, and all the beings on this earth. That is all what He created. He has created the potentialities of food from the earth. So, all the other problems we have created. Therefore, we have the necessity to solve our own problem. So, that is what is called the script on palm leaves. Blavatsky also says that the book is made impermeable to water, fire or air. That means the indweller of our bodies, who is called the permanent ego, is indestructible. These bodies come and go, but the ego is evolving. And the one who is present in these bodies can never be destroyed by fire, because fire is made up of him, can never be destroyed by water or air, because the presence of him is in the form of water and air. This is what he says. The book is said to be the only copy of it now in existence. It has also its esoteric meaning. You are the I am in you, and it is always in a singular number and not a plural. So, the indweller of all these bodies is only singular and is only one always. He has no second one. That is what the Old Testament says. When God appeared before Moses, He said, I have no one except myself. I do not accept a second presence. It is wrongly translated into English in the following words. I, the Lord God, am a jealous God. Jealous. That is wrongly translated, unfortunately. But God is never jealous. But the truth of the original verses is that God presence is only one and it never accepts a second presence. That means there is only one person in all these bodies existing. So Blavatsky describes that only one copy of it is now in existence. This is about the esoteric aspect of the Vedas. The book of Dhyan is also the name given to this book. D.
Right.
Yes. Is it
I
correct?
Think
it is a surprise to know that the word in Sanskrit means meditation. You see, in Patanjali's Yoga Sutras, the words dharana, dhyana, and samadhi. The second one is dhyana. So, here, the meditation means not the meditation of created individuals, but the cosmic entities or cosmic individuals who are found in the body of the eternal existence. Suddenly, they find themselves awakened, just as we wake up in the morning from sleep. They are said to awake in their morning, and they find themselves already working according to the plan, meditating to bring out the cosmic egg. And in the cosmic egg, there are some more such little beings who meditate the existence of the solar system. In each solar system, a group of such beings are awakened once again, and they meditate the existence of the planets. On each planet, again another group of such beings awake, and they begin to meditate for the creation and evolution of the planet. Yes, they are called the Dhyani Buddhas, some of them the Dhyanis, and on the third plane they are called the Buddhas of activity. On the cosmic plane they are called the Pitrus, and on the solar plane they are called the seers or the rishis. So, this is something about the meditation or the dhyan. So, the stanzas on the book of Dhyan, they contain the process of meditation of these eternal beings. How these beings make their periodical meditations at equal intervals of time, whenever there should be the beginning of a cosmic creation. That occasion is called their morning. So, they meditate every morning, just as we meditate every morning. But their interval between two mornings will be our millions and millions of great cycles of time. So, that is the meaning of the word Dhyan. The meditation of the cosmic meditators. The same fellows are described in the Old Testament as the patriarchs, Abraham, Jacob, etc. They are not little beings who ruled on our earth, because they have established the ladder from earth to the heaven and from heaven to the earth. So we should gradually learn the language of the scriptures and get into the habit of reading the scriptures in the language of the authors, not in our language. Another interesting thing is, if you find the original book of the Gospel of Saint John, his name was not John like English, but it was Dhyan, which is equal to this. That is why the revelation of Saint John
in Johannes
in the New Testament contains all the top secrets of creation and destruction. It is an archaic book.
Archaisches Buch.
One of the top scriptures of the world. But unfortunately, what we get now as the revelation of Saint John is much cut off and mutilated by the Christian missionaries, who are not at all capable of reading such books. They have mutilated the book simply because they could not understand it. and they feared that people will question about the science of the book.
Sure.
Then they have to accept the ignorance. So they have to, they cruelly cut off many important parts of that book. This is about the book of Dhyana. It is said to be existing in the cave temples. That means the inner layers of your own consciousness. No doubt these books exist in the outside also as volumes, but the one book that is described in all these books, it exists within yourself and around yourself as the microcosm and the macrocosm,
yes,
as the individual and the universe. So it is also said that it is written in two volumes. The first volume is the macrocosm, that is the origin of the cosmos and the universe. The second volume is yourself, the reader of the book, who exists in this universe. This is the key to read the esoteric language of the scriptures. Blavatsky has much explained about this key in her two books, Isis Unveiled and Secret Doctrine. She has written her volume books also in two volumes. The Isis Unveiled is written in two volumes. Secret Doctrine also written in two volumes. Volume 1 is called Cosmogenesis. Volume 2 is called Anthropogenesis. See, all these scriptures are written in the same texture and division. So, during initiations, they will give us these esoteric. Another author describes this book as follows, that the book belonged to a very, very, very great ancient age, and it is written on pages of human skin in a red liquid, and it could survive through many thousands of years. That means the story of life and evolution is written on the human physical body, and the details of the story are given in your blood as your tendencies, your faculties and capabilities, the psychic and psychological and spiritual abilities that make you understand. This is something about the examples of the esoteric nature of the book. It has a symbolism of its own. Into whichever language it is translated,
sign mark,
and into whichever religion it is adopted, if you translate it as it is, it carries all this esoteric nature. It is enough if we do not use our intelligence in translating it. This is something about this book. Now we go into the next detail. Each of these four Vedas have the following divisions. The stanzas, that is the original mantras, and then we have the oldest commentaries which contain the keys of application. They are called Brahmanas. So the original literature of the Veda is different, and their practical keys and the commentaries are different. And see, the next one we have the science of God, that is collected from the mantras and made into little edition. They can be called the anthology of the mantras. It is called Upanishads. The word mantra means a sound and a meaning to be meditated upon. That is the meaning of the word mantra. A sound and a word to be meditated upon. the word brahmana means expansion, that is an explanations of the meaning of the mantra. Literally it means expansion. The word Upanishad means an approach near. Here it is an approach near to God. Your direct approach to God is given in these books. For example, how to meditate upon God, how to live as God's consciousness. All these things are given in these books. They are only collections made from the original mantras. And then there is the fourth branch of literature, which includes the science of cosmology. Cosmology and embryology put together. It is called Aranyakas. So, every Veda has these four divisions of literature. The mantra literature, which is the original archaic stanzas, which are made into a collection and protected through generations across the many thousands of years. Then the Brahmanas, the commentaries of the mantra. And then the Upanishads, collections and discourses from the mantra. And then the Aranyakas, which contain the science of cosmology and embryology. The name Aranyaka is very esoteric. It means discourses in forests. Aranya means forest. So, gurus and disciples used to gather in forests and they had their sessions of teaching about the origin of the universes and the origin of the individual. They are highly scientific. This is the exotic meaning of the word. The esoteric meaning is the science of an instrument called Arani. Arani is one of the implements of the holy sacrifices. It is made up of two wooden pieces. One fit into the other like this. One wooden piece is fit into another.
And
a string, a rope is tied to the upper one. And they will rotate the upper stick and there will be sparks of fire from it. They will gather the fire with the help of cotton, cotton soaked in ghee, clarified butter. And then they kindle the fire in the sacrifice. So this instrument is called Arani. It is taken as a symbol in these lessons. Each lesson is explained with the help of this symbol. For example, the heaven is described as the upper wood. The earth is described as the lower wood. And the atmospheric friction is described as the rotation. And the life that manifests on this earth into the various bodies is described as the fire. This is one chapter. Under this chapter, a science is explained. Similarly, another chapter